National League, 1970. A year baseball's oldest professional team, the Cincinnati Reds, picked a new label and made it stick. The Big Red Machine. A year the Stars reached new milestones and rewrote the record book. A year more than 16 million fans paid their way into the ballparks, an all-time high. And it was the year of the desperate three-way race in the National League East, charging right down to the wire. On opening day, a World Series flag, and the Amazons go all out to prove it wasn't done with mirrors. They are indeed the stuff the champions are made of. Defense up the middle is still the mark of a winner, and Tommy Agee in center challenged every fly ball. Bud Harrelson matched the record for consecutive errorless games at short, 54, and his partner at second, Ken Boswell, broke the National League record, 85. Nolan Ryan set down 15 Phillies on strikes en route to a one-hitter, a Met record. Until Tom Seaver fanned 19 San Diego Padres 4 days later. It tied a league record, and in the process, Seaver cut down the last 10 batters on strikes, an unparalleled feat. The Chicago Cubs unleashed the most improved bat in the league. It belonged to Jim Hickman. The one-time Met made the comeback of the year, more than doubling his RBI production. In mid-August, the Cubs acquired that free soul, Joe Pepitone, from Houston, and Pepe gave Chicago 100 cents on the dollar. On the 12th of May, the Cubs' Mr. Sunshine, Ernie Banks, stroked his way to a plateau seldom reached by man. San Francisco's Willie Mays still played the game with feeling. The Say Hey Kid, who never said no. And in late July, Willie registered the 3,000th hit of his distinguished career. Time was called to pay tribute to a superstar. On hand for the occasion, Stan the Man Musial, a member of the club, and league president, Chubb Feeney. Earlier in the season, the modest, imperturbable star of two cities, Milwaukee and now Atlanta, took dead aim on number 3,000. And Henry Aaron got it in Cincinnati, the first man ever to put 3,000 hits and 500 home runs together.
You have to realize there have been so many great ball players that have played this game, and I'm speaking about guys, fellas like Ruth, Williams, and just to name a few of them that have played this game.
Over the years, Babe Ruth's 714 home runs have stood the test of time, but Henry Aaron, with those quick wrists, has quietly brought himself into a challenging position. At season's end, Hammer and Henry, the one-time kid off the sandlots of Mobile, Alabama, was 122 homers short of the mountain. Number 557 was a monumental blast that settled in the far reaches of Atlanta Stadium, and it's suitably inscribed for posterity. Atlanta's Hoyt Wilhelm, the knuckleball relief ace, checked into his 1,000th big league ball game. Nobody has ever come close. And amazingly, Wilhelm logged 11 years in the minors before the Giants gave him a chance. Rico Carty's lusty bat clicked off 31 hitting games in a row before the streak ended on this carom shot. The Dominican slugger led the league with a 366 average, the best in 13 years. For more than 60 years, Forbes Field was the home of the Pittsburgh Pirates, as comfortable as an old shoe, and it never played to a no-hitter. The Pirates opened the gates of Three Rivers Stadium in late July with its million-dollar scoreboard, and credit Willie Stargell with the first home run in the new surroundings. Roberto Clemente played the synthetic grass layout as if he'd been there all his life. And in Cincinnati, the lights went out over Crosley Field for the last time on June 24th. The Reds toasted the old ballpark, where Major League Night Baseball was born, with a victory. Riverfront Stadium, a $48 million edifice, opened six nights later. And the Midsummer All-Star Game was played there. Tom Seaver, starting for the Nationals, pitched three shutout innings. Baltimore's Jim Palmer matched Seaver's string over the same three-inning course. And here's the MVP of the game, Carl Yastrzemski, running out one of his four hits. Johnny Bench didn't hit at all, but his rifle arm behind the plate shot down the base-stealing designs of Tommy Harper. Nobody throws like Johnny Bench. It looked like an American League night in the eighth. Yastrzemski led the charge with a single. Ray Fosse followed with another base hit. And that set the stage for a Brooks Robinson triple. The American League on top, 4-1. Held to three hits over the first eight innings, the National League answered back on a homer by San Francisco's Dick Dietz to lead off the ninth. Then Bud Harrelson punched a single to left. And after Clarence Gaston's foul, Joe Morgan clipped another single to right. And with the tying runs aboard, Willie McCovey kept it going with another hit to make it 4-3, the tying run on third. And when Roberto Clemente raised a fly ball to center, Morgan scored from third, the game moving into extra innings. There were two out in the 12th when Pete Rose delivered his first hit after striking out twice. Then Billy...